All right, if you have your Bible, please open it to the book of Philemon. Philemon. For those of you who are paging around, I want to remind you there is a little table of contents in the front of your Bible. Might need to utilize that this week. Philemon. We'll be getting there in a few minutes. I'd like to start today by telling you a story. It's a story I saw in a movie this last week. And I want you just to, once you found that, just put your Bible on your lap and just listen and enter the story. It's a story of a man named Carlos. Carlos was one of those guys that stands around on the street corner with a bunch of other guys, hoping to get some work that day. Carlos had come across the border with his wife, and they'd lived together for quite a while, but America changed her. She wanted more than Carlos could provide for her. So shortly after their son Luis was born, she deserted them. So now Carlos was an illegal, unemployed, single parent in a strange land, battling day to day just to provide a life for his son. Standing on the corner one day, a guy named Briscoe chose him. Briscoe owned a truck and a landscaping business, and Carlos became his most loyal and diligent worker. And so he had steady work as he worked with Briscoe every day. A couple years later, Briscoe told him, "I'm going back to Mexico, and I want to sell my truck and my business to you." Carlos was very excited. He said, "How much?" And he said, $10,000. It was the opportunity of a lifetime, because if he could get the truck and the business, all of a sudden he could provide a better life for his son. Problem was, Carlos had no money. He'd been saving it the whole time he'd been in America working. He'd been saving it so he could hire a lawyer and get legal. He hired a lawyer, and the lawyer stole his money and ran. So he had none left. All he wanted was a better life for his son, Luis. A better neighborhood, better schools. Luis was 14 years old now. He'd started skipping school. He'd become Americanized. He and his relationship with his dad was strained. The gangs that were prevalent in his neighborhood were wooing him. And Carlos knew that this season in his son's life was crucial. His future was hanging in the balance, and he was torn. The next day, Briscoe put the truck on the market, so Carlos went back where he started, to the street corner. He stood there with the men, hoping to find work. At the end of the morning, he was one of two left. The other was a guy named Francisco, who was kind. Offered him some bread. At first he refused, but then he took it and was grateful. He didn't get work that day, and he realized he was going to have to take a chance. So he called his sister and asked her for a loan to buy their truck and the company. And she came over that night with an envelope with $10,000 in it. She hadn't talked to her husband because she knew he would say no. And when he asked him, "Where did you get this money?" she said, "We've been putting a little apart from every check that we've had since we came to America, and it's our family emergency medical fund in case something happens with one of the kids." And Carlos said, "I can't use this." She said, "Use it. It's your only chance for a better life." He took the money. He called his friend Briscoe, and he bought the truck. The next day was his first day with the truck. He returned to the place where the migrant workers congregated. As he drove up, they all rushed out because they all wanted to get hired. He looked through the mass of faces, and there in the back he saw Francisco, the kind man who had given him bread the day before. He pointed at Francisco, and he ran and jumped in the truck. And he gave him an opportunity to work with him. One of the things that he had to do was he had to take this strap and shimmy all the way up these very tall palm trees. And then he would hack off the dead leaves up there, whatever they're called. It took quite a while to get up. Before he went, he threw his jacket down and his cell phone and his truck keys, and off he went up the tree. When he got to the top, he looked out over the city of L.A. He loved the view from up there. But he needed to get to work, and so he looked down to ask Francisco to throw up a tool to him, and Francisco wasn't there. And then he looked on his jacket, and his cell phone was gone, and the keys were gone, too. As he looked across the lawn to the street, he could see Francisco running towards the truck, and he realized he was going to take the truck, and so he tried desperately to get down the tree, but it was slow going, and by the time he ran across the yard, Francisco was driving into the distance, and he stole the truck. And with the truck, he stole his sister's emergency medical money, and he stole his son's hope for a better life. Carlos, understandably, was livid. He was heartbroken. So now he's a livid, heartbroken, illegal, unemployed, single parent in a strange land with a $10,000 debt he can never repay. What a desperate place to be. He searched with Luis all over the barrio, all over southern L.A., looking for Francisco, hoping to find him so they could get the truck back. They finally ran him down at a place where he washes dishes at night, a restaurant. He chases him out of the kitchen. Luis is waiting for him in the parking lot, and Luis tackles him. Carlos pulls him off, and he says, "Where's my truck?" And it's then that Francisco tells him, "I sold it this morning on the black market for $3,000. And I sent the money to Mexico." With that, Carlos realizes his dream is over. So who is your Francisco? Do you have one? There's someone in your life who ripped you off. That's your Francisco. There's someone in your life who took advantage of you. There's someone in your life who hurt you so deeply you haven't even gotten to the bottom of the pain yet. There's someone in your life who made a choice that reversed your fortunes and you're still trying to dig out. Anyone coming to mind? I'm not going to tell you what happens in the rest of the movie. The movie's called A Better Life. I recommend it. It's a good movie. But I'm going to provide for you an alternate ending. For two reasons. I don't want to spoil the movie, and I think mine's better. I think mine's better because it just simply would never happen outside of Christ. But I want to walk you through it. Okay? So hit the music. Okay, so we left Carlos angry and bitter. Over the next few months, he gets more and more angry and more bitter. Luis, hopeless now, is initiated into a gang. It's the only place he can really find community. His body becomes a canvas for tats, gang tats, and bruises. Carlos can't face his sister. He's so ashamed. He doesn't even return her phone calls anymore. He actually considers trying to go back over the border. He's convinced he's probably the only one that's ever thought of that. Because surely it was better there than here. His bitterness is eating him alive. Now Carlos is an acrimonious, heartbroken, illegal, unemployed, single parent in a strange land with a $10,000 debt he could never repay, an estranged sister and a son flushing his life down the toilet. All because of this guy named Francisco. He hates Francisco. 6 months later, there's a knock on the door. He opens it, and guess who's standing there? Francisco. And all the anger and all the bitterness that's been building up for month after month after month, as soon as he sees Francisco, it boils to the surface. And he reaches towards him. And as he's reaching towards him, Francisco holds up an envelope. And he recognizes the handwriting on the envelope. And it says, "Sisters." And Francisco says, "Read this." And with his hands shaking, he opens the envelope. And here's what it says. Dear Carlos, I miss you and I love you. I know you're a good man and I want to draw on that kindness in you, and I want to ask you to do a favor. I've gotten to know Francisco since your unfortunate experience with him. He's told me how badly he feels for destroying your dream. He knows he was wrong. I shared Christ with him, and he's given himself over to Jesus. He's really changed, Carlos. I've seen it with my own eyes. He wants to come and work with you again, and I want to ask you to forgive him. Trust him. Take him in like he's part of your family and treat him with love. Will you do that? If you can't do it for him, please, please, Carlos, do it for me. I hope to visit you soon. Until then, please show grace and kindness to Francisco. With much love, your sister. Can you feel the tension? It's almost an unfair thing to ask, isn't it? Especially sending Francisco to deliver the letter. I mean, come on, he's standing right there. That's hard. Two questions immediately pop into my mind when I think about this scenario. Why in the world would Carlos forgive him? And how in the world could Carlos forgive him? The book of Philemon in the Bible answers those two questions for Carlos. But then we're not talking about Carlos, are we? He's just a character in a movie. We're actually talking about us, you and me, and the real life that we live in. Because there's someone in my life who ripped me off. There's someone in my life who took advantage of me. There's someone in my life who hurt me so deeply, I haven't even gotten to the bottom of that pain yet. There's someone in my life who made a choice that reversed my fortunes. All of us have experienced this. So the person that is dominating your thoughts as I'm reading this story, that's the person the Holy Spirit wants you thinking about today and applying this sermon to. They say that refusing to forgive someone is like drinking poison, hoping that your enemy dies. Because that's the effect it has on us. Unforgiveness eats us away inside. S.I. Macmillan said it this way, quote, "The moment I start hating a man, I become his slave," end quote. So Ephesians 4:32, Paul tells us, be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving Francisco, just as in Christ God forgave you. Didn't say Francisco, but forgiving each other, just as in Christ God forgave you. In Colossians 3, therefore as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, therefore those of you that have been transformed by Christ, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, patience. Bear with each other and forgive whatever grievances you may have against one another. Forgive as the Lord forgave you. We've read those passages before. You know that as believers we're supposed to forgive. But we come up with lots of reasons to withhold forgiveness, don't we? We're good at this. I want to share a little list with you, see if you can relate to any of these. And I have my wife, Libby, to thank for this list. Not because she uses all these excuses, because she, along with a friend, Carol, teach a class, and they taught this, and she shared her notes with me. See if you resonate with any of these. Forgiving someone makes me look weak, and I need to be strong. Fact of the matter is, God isn't interested in me being strong. He's interested in me trusting him. That's all he cares about. I'm right, and I don't have to give in. It's one of the biggest reasons we don't forgive, because, well, doggone it, we're right, and they're wrong. But life is not about right and wrong. It's about life and death. Holding the debt against them gives me control, and I need to be in control. Always remember, the thing that I try to control ends up controlling me. I don't know if you know that or not. Control, my friends, is an illusion. You have zero control over anything in your life. If I forgive, I may get hurt again, and I need to protect myself. The truth is, you can't protect yourself. You live in a fallen world. You will get hurt again, whether you forgive or not. It might be too painful. The whole process might be too painful. What you got to remember is that holding on to the pain and the pain leaks into other areas of your life. Holding on to bitterness does not relieve the pain. If I ignore the problem, it will go away. No, it won't. I don't want anything in my past to control my present. And if I refuse to forgive, then something that happened in the past is now controlling my present. I want them to pay for it. They need to be punished and learn a lesson, right? So my withholding forgiveness in some way punishes them. Fact of the matter is they're not even noticing. And Scripture is very clear. Vengeance belongs to the Lord. Romans 12:17. Do not repay anyone evil for evil. Be careful to do what is right in the eyes of everybody. If it is possible, as far as it depends on you, recognizing not everyone will respond to your reaching out in grace. If it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. Do not take revenge, my friends, but leave room for God's wrath. For it is written, it is mine to avenge. I will repay, says the Lord. Instead, on the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he's thirsty, give him something to drink. In doing this, you will heap burning coals on his head. He won't know how to respond to grace. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. Another excuse. I'm going to wait for the offending party to come to me. I'm waiting for that person to be sorry for what they've done. That may never happen. It might never happen. I don't feel like forgiving them, so forgiving them would be hypocritical. We're digging deep now, aren't we? I'm trying to find some reason not to do this. Fact of the matter is, who I am in Christ is a forgiving person. Am I right? If I am in Christ, it is natural for me to forgive because he wants to forgive through me. And if hypocrisy is not living who I really am, if I am in Christ a forgiver, then it is actually hypocritical not to forgive. I'm waiting for a convenient time and a feeling of love for that person. It's never going to be a convenient time. That feeling may never come. What's amazing about this story that I just told you and the story we're about to read in Scripture is that the story actually goes way beyond forgiveness. The story goes beyond forgiveness to reconciliation. One person can forgive, it takes two to reconcile. That's why it's so tricky. Reconciliation is not just passing the grocery store test. You know what this is? Okay, so you're struggling with someone, you have a fracture in your relationship, and you're at Kroger and you're walking down the frozen goods aisle, and all of a sudden, there's Francisco, right there, or Francisca. The question is, do you skip over into the pizza aisle? Whew. Or are you able to walk up, greet warmly, authentically, in love, a friend? Reconciliation has taken place if, in Kroger, you can walk up, authentically, lovingly, greet a friend. Because reconciliation is enemies becoming friends. It's a lot deeper than forgiveness. I can forgive someone, just me alone with Jesus in the quietness of my own home. Reconciliation requires me working out something with someone else and starting a new relationship, much deeper, much more difficult. Philemon shows us an everyday situation, an everyday example of everything that Paul teaches on reconciliation. And in Philemon, we learn why we should do this and how we can do it. So you ready to dive in? Verse 1, here's how the letter starts. Paul, a prisoner of Christ Jesus, he was most likely in prison in Ephesus when he wrote this letter, and Timothy, our brother, to Philemon, our dear friend and fellow worker. Philemon was the leader of the house church in Colossae. To Apphia, our sister, that was Philemon's wife, to Archippus, our fellow soldier, and to the church that meets in your home. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. That's not a throwaway phrase there in verse 3, by the way. Grace to you and peace. Paul's goal in this letter is, in the context of grace, I want you to live at peace with one another. Grace leads to peace. Not only peace with God, but peace with one another, our brothers and sisters in Christ as well. So here's the short story. Philemon is the Carlos in our story. He had a servant or a slave named Onesimus, he's the Francisco in our story, who had run away to Ephesus and had likely stolen a lot of money from Philemon when he left. Philemon came home one day to discover that his slave has betrayed him, robbed from him, stolen, and run away. We believe that Philemon was a really good, godly, gracious guy. Look how Paul describes him in verse 4. I always thank my God as I remember you in my prayers, because I hear about your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love for all the saints. Once again, this is not a throwaway phrase. Paul recognizes this is a loving man, and the reason he's loving is because he trusts Jesus. He's not only trusted Christ for salvation, he's trusting Jesus moment by moment by moment in everyday life. And the result of that is that this love just pours out of him to the people around him. He's a good man. So Onesimus took advantage of and robbed a godly, gracious guy, and he ran away. Onesimus, as God would have it, made his way to Ephesus, where Paul was in prison. And somehow he met Paul. Who knows? Maybe he spent a night in jail. I don't know. But there, Paul shared the gospel with him, and he said yes to Jesus, and he was radically transformed. And now Paul's got a problem. He's thinking, what do I do with this kid? He really should go back to his master. He's a brother in Christ now. Lord, what do you want me to do? Here's what Paul did. He grabbed his young understudy by the name of Tychius. He said, Tychius, come here. I want you to take Onesimus. I've written a letter for the church in Colossae, and I want you two to deliver it to the leader of the church there. To which Tychius said, that's Philemon, right? Yeah, deliver it to Philemon. I'm taking Onesimus with me to deliver the letter to Philemon, right? Yeah, you know what? Let me write a letter on that front too. And so Paul sat down and wrote the letter to Philemon, and both of them were delivered by Onesimus and Tychius to Philemon. So the little scenario I described before, one day there's a knock on Philemon's door. He opens it up, and there stands Onesimus. And as the frustration, anger, bitterness, whatever has been growing in him over the last few months starts to boil, and as he starts to reach out, he holds up a letter, and he recognizes the handwriting. It's Paul's. Is before you hurt me, read this. So Philemon opens the letter. And it's these words from Paul. Don't worry about it. These words from Paul, asking him to forgive Onesimus and be reconciled to him. And the question, of course, is how and why. And both of those questions are answered in verse 6. Verse 6 is the key verse to this whole letter. Are you ready? I pray, okay, so I'm asking God to do something supernatural here because, Philemon, I know in your flesh you can't do this, but I'm praying that God does a miracle here. I pray that you may be active in sharing your faith so that you will have a full understanding of every good thing we have in Christ. Here's the why. Why would you do this, Philemon? Because it leads to a fuller experience of Christ. It says, so that, that's the purpose clause right there in the middle of the verse. Here's, I'm going to tell you why you would forgive him, so that you'll have a full understanding of every good thing, literally in the original language, the last four words, in us unto Christ. It's a little clumsy in the original language. Here's what he's getting at. The little words in us is a reminder that God is at work in his people, that it is God who births and brings to fruition reconciliation. He's got to do it in us. But it's not just in us, it's unto Christ. And commentators love to discuss what Paul meant by unto Christ here. I think he's talking about unity in the Spirit, and it's the same thought that we see in Ephesians chapter 4 where he said this, until we all reach unity in the faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God and become mature, attaining to the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. Part of attaining the whole measure of the fullness of Christ is living in reconciled relationships. Paul is saying, hey, do you want to experience life in Christ to the full? I mean, if I had a show of hands, you want to experience life? Let's do it. Do you want to experience life in Christ to the full? Put your hand up. Yeah? The fullness? Yeah. If that's your desire, here's what he's saying. All your broken relationships, make sure the Holy Spirit is bringing reconciliation in those relationships, because in that relationship reconciliation, you will experience Christ in a new and rich and real way you never have before. Why would I do it? because it leads to a fuller experience of Christ. Well, Peter, are there any other reasons? Do you need any other reasons? So how do I do it? If I want this, how do I do it? Look at the beginning of the verse. I pray that you may be active in sharing your faith. This sounds like a proof text for an evangelism conference, doesn't it? We want you to be active in sharing your faith. And so if you read it just like that, if I'm active in sharing my faith, then my relationships are going to get restored. No, that's not what Paul's saying. The word sharing there is the word koinonia. Koinonia. Back in the 70s, everyone in the church knew the word koinonia. It's a great word. It means body life. It means fellowship. But when we talk about fellowship, it kind of sounds like a potluck after church, because that's what fellowship's kind of become to mean. It means sharing, which is how the NIV folks decided to translate it. But because they put it within your faith, sharing your faith, it sounds like evangelism, and that's not what he's getting at. It means an exchange. It means to be interrelated. It means to be in union. It means to be one with. We, if we are in Christ, have koinonia with the Father, and Paul is reminding Philemon that if you are in Christ, you have koinonia with your brothers and sisters too. And so how do I do this? He says, I pray that you may be active in your koinonia that comes from your faith in Christ. What Paul is saying is you can believe in koinonia as a theory, as a theology, but I want to take you to the next step. I want you to apply koinonia to your relationships. I want the oneness that you have with your brothers and sisters in Christ to be deep enough, to be rich enough, to be real enough that you actually find reconciliation in your relationships. Okay, Paul, I want to do this because I want to fully experience Christ. And I realize that the way I'm going to do it is I'm going to apply or activate koinonia in my life. How does this work? What does it look like? Okay, so this letter is actually a drama. I don't know if you knew this or not. It's actually a drama played out with three characters. And so I need a couple volunteers. Mike King and Kurt Baxter. Thank you for volunteering. Come on up here, guys. They didn't know I was going to do this. This might be a little clumsy, but bear with me. Because I want you to see the drama. Mike, you go over here. Thank you, brother, for coming up. Right there, and you face that way. Kurt, you stand right there facing this way, okay? Thank you, brother. Appreciate you coming up. Okay, so here's the drama. There are three people in this drama. There is Philemon, there is Onesimus, and there is Paul. I'm Paul. Now, Martin Luther, in his commentary on Philemon, makes an amazing point, and I think he nails it. Paul, in this drama, is playing the role of Christ. Paul, in this drama, is playing the role of Christ. Remember the role of Christ in reconciliation? There was this problem. Mankind was full of sin, and God, over here, desperately wanted to have a relationship with us. And so God the Father talked to God the Son. I'm Christ now. God the Father talked to God the Son, said, go. And God the Son became man in the incarnation and identified with the human race. And in identifying with the human race, at the same time identifying with the Father, he was fully God and fully man, going to the cross, sacrificing himself, raising again from the dead, he made it possible that if anyone turns to him, in that moment they are transformed and he breathes his life into them and they are new creations. And in doing so, he brings God into union, oneness with mankind. Okay? Thank you, guys. Go back. We're not done yet. Okay, so that's the grand story. That's the grand story of reconciliation, right? That is the drama that we see in this letter. Okay, but now it's not God the Father and sinful mankind and Christ. It's Philemon, Onesimus, and Paul playing the Christ role. And here's how the argument goes. Philemon, verses 1 through 7, you are one with me. Onesimus, verses 10 through 14, he is one with me. So, verses 15 through 20, I'm going to bring you two together because if I am one with you and I am one with him, then guess what? You are one together. Let me show you how it works. First of all, in verses 1 through 7, look at the phrases that God uses to describe how Paul is one with Philemon. It says, Paul, a prisoner of Christ Jesus, we're going to act this out, guys, just follow my lead. And Timothy, our brother, to Philemon, our dear friend and fellow worker. He's saying, I identify with you, Philemon. He starts walking him towards. To Apphia, our sister, so he calls his wife his sister. To Archippus, our fellow soldier, and to the church that meets in your home. Listen to how he describes his relationship with Philemon. Your love has given me great joy. The way you've loved me has brought great joy into my life. There's an intimate relationship here. And encouragement. You've been an encouragement to me over the years because you, brother, an intimate way to describe it, the relationship, have refreshed the hearts of the saints. So in the first 7 verses, he's reminding Philemon, you and me, we're an intimate relationship because we're in Christ. And then here comes the big ask. You ready, Philemon? Here's what I'm going to ask you to do. Therefore, although in Christ, I could be bold and I could order you to do this. I'm not going to do that because I'm going to appeal to you on the basis of love. I then, as Paul, an old man, it could be translated an ambassador for Christ, and now also a prisoner of Christ Jesus, I appeal to you for my son, Onesimus. So he's asking him to reconcile with Onesimus. So the next thing he's going to do in verses 10 through 14, he's going to say, I want you to see, Philemon, that I'm one with Onesimus too. Listen to the terminology he uses. I appeal to you for my son, Onesimus, who became my son while I was in chains. Okay, stop for a second. Paul led Onesimus to the Lord when he was in prison. I love the way the Message translates this verse. It says, while here in jail, I've fathered a child, so to speak. And here he is, hand-carrying this letter, Onesimus. I mean, to call someone your son, that's intimate, isn't it? That's intimate. This is my boy. It's my son. I am one with him. For my son Onesimus, who became my son while I was in chains. Formerly he was useless to you because he ran away, but now he has become useful both to you and to me. The word Onesimus means useful, so this is a play on words. So useful was useless to you because he ran away, but now useful has become useful not only to me but also to you. He's starting to bring them together. I do wish, brother, connection, I do wish, brother, that I may have some benefit from you in the Lord. Oh, wait a second, I skipped ahead. I'm sending you, verse 12, right? I'm sending him who is my very heart. That's intimate. He's my very heart. I'm sending him back to you. I would have liked to keep him with me so that he could take your place in helping me while I'm in chains for the gospel, but I didn't want to do anything without your consent so that any favor you will do will be spontaneous. And not forced. I'm not going to force you to do this, Philemon. I want it to be spontaneous. So Paul starts to bring them together in verse 15. Look at this. Perhaps the reason he was separated you from a little while was so that you might have him back for good. No longer as a slave, but better than a slave, as a dear brother. So pause button. You used to have him as a slave. He ran away. This has been terrible. Here's what I'm asking you to do. I'm asking you to reconcile because the relationship you will have after you reconcile will be better and deeper than the one you had before. Be better and deeper than the one you had before. Look how he ends this verse. He, Onesimus, is very dear to you, to me, but even dearer to you. Here's where he says, okay, come on, put your arm around each other.
Brother.
Just stay there. Don't move.
Nice try.
Hug.
Are you serious?
Yeah, I'm serious. Okay, now, I know it's awkward, but this letter is awkward. Just stand there, all right? Seriously, listen, okay? Here's where Paul really starts to turn the screws. So if you consider me a partner, Philemon, if you identify yourself with me, welcome him as you would welcome me. Why? Because I'm one with him, I'm one with you. You've got to realize you're one together. If he has done you any wrong or owes you anything, charge it to me. I'm Paul, I'm writing this with my own hand. I will pay it back, not to mention that you owe me your very self. You guys can, this is a little awkward. You can.
Oh, yeah.
No, just like guys. There you go. Just like that. Okay, don't lose this. Don't lose this, all right? Paul, I'm writing this with my own hand. I will pay you back, not to mention that you owe me your very self. This is funny, right? This is a little humor. He's saying, Philemon, I want you to do me this favor, not to mention that if it wasn't for me, you wouldn't even know Jesus. I can't say that, so I won't mention it, but I just want to write it just to remind you that I know it, even though I'm not saying it. I do wish, brother, that I may have some benefit from you in the Lord. Refresh my heart in Christ. Confident of your obedience, I write to you knowing that you will do even more than I ask. Even more than I ask. And one more thing. Prepare a guest room for me because I'm coming soon. He sends greetings from others. And then in verse 25, the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with your spirit. Thank you, guys, for being our picture. You can go sit back down. I think Paul ends that way on purpose. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be in your spirit, because there's no way this can happen without the grace of Jesus making it happen. And the question I want to leave you with today is, who are you in that story? Because this is how we're going to apply it. Who are you in this story? Maybe you are Philemon, and Francisco has messed you up. And you are deeply wounded, and you're deeply angry, and you're hurting, and you're bitter. And you know you need to forgive, and you know you need to reconcile, and it scares you to death. Maybe you're Onesimus. Maybe you're Francisco. Maybe as you're sitting here today, you're thinking of someone that you have terribly wronged. You desperately want to restore that relationship, but you don't know where to start. If you are Philemon or Onesimus, here's what this letter teaches us. Here's the application. Are you ready? Ask for help. Ask for help. Maybe you're Paul. This is what's really cool about this letter. Maybe what God's laying on your heart right now as you're listening to me preach is that he wants you to play the Paul, the Jesus role, to bring two fractured people together. Maybe as I've been preaching, you've thought about a relationship that's in your life, a guy and a guy, a gal and a gal, a guy and a gal, whatever, who are apart from each other, and it's breaking your heart. And as you're sitting there listening to me, you're thinking, oh my Lord, I think you want me to be Paul. If that is cool, that's awesome. Here's what this verse, this chapter, this book says to you. Offer to help. It's really pragmatic. Offer to help. Because remember, forgiveness can happen just between me and God. I can do it in the quietness of my own home. But reconciliation requires two. Wait a second. No. Most times, it requires three. Because we get so hurt and so wounded, we just can't figure out how to get back together. You say, well, I like to think I can kind of take care of this by myself. I don't want to involve any third parties, Pete. I don't need any help. It's a sign of weakness to need help. I just want to remind you that God the Father solicited God the Son's help to bring us back together. I mean, if God was willing to step into that, maybe we could be too. If God's calling you to be a Paul, here's my encouragement to you this week. Just call up or email both of the people and ask them one-on-one to go out for coffee with you. Say, I heard this sermon. Here's what God laid on my heart. Are you willing to have a conversation, the three of us? I want to try and bring you two together. See what happens. See what happens. If you are Philemon or Onesimus and someone calls you this week, the answer is yes. Because that's the Holy Spirit working to restore a relationship so that all of you might experience the fullness of life in Christ. Here's what I want you to do. I want you to take out a piece of paper and a pen or a pencil, if you have one. We're just going to have a few moments of response here. And if God has laid someone on your heart that you are in a fractured relationship with, and the desire to see reconciliation in that relationship, I encourage you to write that person's, just their first name, on a piece of paper. Or maybe God's laying on your heart to be a Paul between two fractured people. Just write both of their first names on a piece of paper and tear it off. And I'm going to give you a moment just to pray and talk to the Lord about this. And allow the Holy Spirit to lead you to a place where he engages you in the process of reconciliation. And if you sense him doing that, I'm going to encourage you, while we're having this time of reflection, just to sneak out and come down here and take that little piece of paper and stick it in the wall down here between the stones. And then just kneel and pray and say, all right, Lord, in this moment, I give this relationship to you. Do something. Do a miracle. Bring restoration and reconciliation. I pray.